Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. Paul's. And if you're watching online this morning, a very special welcome to you as well. If you're with us for the first time today, you're very welcome as well. I'm Andrew, one of the church wardens, and today is our Harvest Festival service. Pete Luther is going to be bringing us a video message a little bit later on about the work of Revive in Newport and Food Bank, which is where our harvest gifts will be going this year. And John Yates is going to be bringing us a word in a few minutes from John 15, verses 12 to 17. So if you want to look those up in your Bibles or on your phones, that's the reading he's going to be doing in a little bit later. There will be a time and an opportunity for sharing. I know some people have said that they would like to share something. I asked you last week if anybody had any things for Thanksgiving that they'd like to share. So that's going to come after John's talk a little bit later. And of course, if you have any prayers that you'd like to share during during our time of worship, then please raise your hand and Liz will come to you with the microphone on the extended boom. And again, if you're watching online, you can text those in as well. Do pray for our children's group that are meeting this morning over the road, our young people's group, and that Refresh, our older young people group, will be meeting after this morning's service as well. So if I can invite John to come up, and I'll just pray for you, John. You can take your mask off. You're allowed to take your mask off when you come up front. If you'd like to stand or raise a hand, then we'll just pray for John before we start this morning. Father God, we pray for John as he brings your word to us today. Father, we pray for our service here, Harvest, today. Father, we just pray that it would be an offering of praise and thanksgiving to you. But we pray, Lord, that the word that John brings will be a word in season and for us today. We pray for your Holy Spirit to come upon him as he brings this word to us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, John. So we're going to do our opening prayer this morning and collect and confession. Here's the opening prayer as we start. We've come together in the name of Christ, offer praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. Amen. And let's say the collect together. Gracious God, you call us to fullness of life. Deliver us from unbelief and banish our anxieties with the liberating love of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's just keep a few moments quiet before we say our confession together. God's whole creation groans. The land produces thorns and thistles and longs to be set free. Our sin affects all around us. We confess our sins in penitence and faith. And we say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our opening hymn this morning is These Are the Days of Elijah. Let's worship the Lord.
Thank you. Our reading this morning is taken from John chapter 15, 9 to 17. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. Amen.
Good morning. I've been asked to share a little quick word this morning, and that's all it will be, and I'm struggling to do that. But I want to share with you a short word on spiritual fruit. Jesus said to his disciples, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remain in me, I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." Preparing for a spiritual harvest, Jesus is coming back for the harvest. And in verse 16, I want to focus on that for the next few moments. Jesus said, "You did not choose me, but I chose or appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. You I have appointed to go and bear fruit, fruit that will remain." Verse 16. So God chose us. He's speaking to his disciples. Speaking to the disciples, he said, I chose you, you didn't choose me. And we're here this morning because God has chosen us. He's chosen the disciples. He knew you before the foundation of the world, and he is with you this morning, and you're here because the Holy Spirit has brought you in. Just Jesus appointed us to go, or appointed us to bear fruit. Fruit that will remain. We're not making church members, but disciples. Disciples that will grow into something that God is calling us to be. A disciple is one who follows Jesus. The word for disciple, I believe, is an apprentice. Some of us was an apprentice. I was an apprentice at the age of 15, and I followed the men that was the persons that was trained and the people that was teaching us, and we had to do what we was told, like make a cup of tea and make the tea the right way, etc. Disciples never walked in front of Jesus. They followed him and listened to him and trusted every word. And when he had chosen them, he chose them because he knew all about them, even before or even when they was in their mother's womb. He knew their character. Each one of us are different. We're all different in many ways. We've got different emphasis on how we should conduct ourselves, different personalities to be able to help other people. Jesus has appointed us to go. So that is a great calling, that Jesus has appointed us, each one of us, to go and make disciples and bear fruit. And as we bear fruit, we touch other people's lives. It's like the harvest, it doesn't just come, it is there's a lot of work involved in preparing the soil and sowing, and then there's the reaping and bringing the harvest in. We are all under go orders to make disciples. Jesus said, go into all the world and make disciples. If someone is coming to Christ and they know and have trusted him and have been brought into the kingdom, they will remain. Jesus is asking us to bring forth fruit that will remain and bring it in to the barns and the stores. If the fruit isn't pure and ripe, then they will fall away. If it's not harvested and left on the fields, the birds and it will have it, and it'll just rot there. So he's calling us to produce fruit, and Jesus is returning for the harvest. We've been chosen to be sowers and reap an harvest, and Jesus is coming back for his bride. And often in the world today, and even in many parts of the world, brides have to prepare themselves for the groom. It's the bride's job to make themselves ready for the marriage. And Jesus is coming back for his bride. And we are responsible. It's only the church that can change the world. We're called to change the world. And in many cases, the world has come into the church. And God wants us to go out and make disciples. And in these difficult days that we're in now, it's a great opportunity for the church and each one of us, with our own personalities and our own giftings, can touch other people's lives. we can demonstrate Jesus in our lives, that we can shine, rise and shine, for your light has come. And God has called us to prepare the harvest for Jesus coming back. Jesus is returning for his harvest and has entrusted us and appointed us to make disciples, not church members. I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He's coming to take us away. We will be with him. He will take his bride away out of all the mess and conflicts that's going on in the world. He will come back for his bride, for those that overcome, and for those who are waiting for his coming back. I will come again and receive you. So the best is yet to come. We have a great inheritance. Crowns waiting for those who have been serving God in various ways. There will be a reward. But the end reward is to spend eternity in God's eternal kingdom. And in conclusion, the feast of ingathering. I want to talk about the Feast of Tabernacles. When the Jewish people came out of Egypt and went into the Sinai desert, they slept in booths. And just after, in Israel, after they have harvested and all the harvest is brought in to the stores, then it's time to celebrate Tabernacles or Sukkot. The harvest Feast of Tabernacles is also known as the Feast of Ingathering. It finds its prophetic fulfillment in the end time harvest of souls from among the Jew and the Gentile, the bride of Christ, the one new man. My tabernacle will be with them. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Then the nations will know that I, the Lord, make Israel and Gentiles holy when my sanctuary is among them forever. Shall we pray? Father, we give you praise and thanks for the great calling, the high calling of serving you. Thank you for your divine presence, and without your Holy Spirit, all our righteousness is as filthy rags. Lord, Holy Spirit, come and empower your people. Strengthen us, equip us, that we might realize that it's you that's ordained us. And when we go in your strength, we have all the backing of heaven behind us. We are in the victory. You've ordained us. You've filled us with your Spirit. And I pray this morning, Lord, for everyone listening to my voice, will begin to understand that we are in the victory in Christ as a result of Calvary. If there's anyone this morning that needs healing or separated from fears and anxieties, Lord, I pray that you'll touch them at the point of need and bless them and strengthen your people, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, John. Last week, I asked anybody if they had anything they'd like to share, to give thanks for. And I've got three people who've got things to share. Has anybody else got anything to share that they've not indicated so far? Okay. John over there. Okay. Liz, do you want to go to John first and then let John share?
At the beginning of lockdown, at the last service that we had in church here, we all said together Psalm 91. That psalm is full of promise, it's full of hope, it's got everything that we need in it, and it's telling us that God is in control and that we can trust him at all times. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
Can I go to Tina? Go across, that's fine.
I'd like to thank for St Paul's family, and that's firstly Jesus Christ. I feel that Jesus Christ has given me the strength to try and improve the lives of people with a visual impairment in a small way. This week has been a week like no other. It's been extraordinary, and I can't believe I've actually managed to achieve working with Hampshire and Isle of Wight Police, Thames Valley Police, to achieve a protocol to keep blind people safe. It was about a year ago when I had a policeman knocking on the door. He was investigating a burglary at a neighbouring property. He had a print warrant card, and I felt under pressure to let him in. It was only after the event that I thought I shouldn't have let him in. He could have been absolutely anybody. And at that point, I turned to Radio Solent, because they have a newsmaker sort of column on radio every morning, and Radio Solent got on board with my campaign to try and get the police to introduce a password system for visually impaired people. Throughout lockdown, I worked with Hampshire Police, and it was Inclusion Week this week, and on the 29th of September, they launched their visually impaired persons protocol. How it works is that if a policeman comes to your door, you will have to take their name, their call sign number, which is unique to every policeman's on his radio, and their collar number, which is unique to every policeman. If you can't remember that information, which I wouldn't be able to, I will just ring 101 and I'll say, I have a policeman stood outside my door. His name's PC Smith. He's investigating a burglary. I'm visually impaired and I would like to set up a password. Could you give him my password? Now, if he rings the doorbell and the password doesn't match, then he doesn't come in. So I'd like to thank, well, I do feel that Jesus has given me some inner strength to try and be an advocate for visually impaired people. And without St. Paul's family and all their prayers, when I was at my weakest point when I lost Nushka, I couldn't have achieved any of this. And I feel that the St. Paul's family and Jesus has been behind me, and I don't know what's ahead at the moment, but I feel that he's given me a mission to improve the lives of people with visual impairment.
Anybody else? Liz, do you want to share yourself?
Yes, this is from a little devotional that I read the other day. I'll read part of it. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground night and day. While he's asleep or awake, the seed sprouts and grows, but he does not understand how it happens. Googling is great and gives us speedy access to libraries of knowledge, but even so, the world is still full of mysteries. In these verses, Jesus speaks of the mystery of the kingdom of God. Day and night, rain and shine, the kingdom of God grows, just as a farmer has no understanding of how growth happens. So we too cannot fathom how God works. It is simply an amazing miracle. The wonderful truth is that the kingdom of God is growing all over the world. On those days when you can't see any growth, we have every reason to praise God that miraculously the kingdom is still growing. We don't know how he does it, but he does, and that's what matters. It's a little prayer that goes with this. Loving Father, we thank you for the miracle of your kingdom. May our faith and confidence in you grow day by day. Amen.
Thank you to everybody who shared this morning. We're going to worship and respond now to John's message and to those words this morning. So let's worship the Lord together.
Done great things. freedom awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Saviour, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Hallelujah, God above it all.
Hallelujah, God above it all. Hallelujah, God unshakable.
Running after me. My life laid down, I surrender. sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yes,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
As we come before the throne of grace this morning, bring those we know in our family, our church family, who are unwell at this time and who need our prayers. Father, we lift up to you Stella this morning, and Frank. We pray for Sue and her family, and we pray for Tracy, Gordon and Norma as well. We continue to pray for Alex, Karen and Hannah and Samuel, for the different challenges they are facing. We thank the Lord that Karen's position at work is now safe, but we pray for Hannah as she has appointments this week. We give thanks, Lord, as well, especially for Brian and Brenda Drake for their anniversary this week. For St. Paul's as well. Lord, we pray that your blessing will be upon this church and upon our church family. We pray for all those who are struggling. Please strengthen each one of us in our faith and help us to be a people that are pleasing to you. We pray, Lord, for the future of this church. Pray that it will be blessed and secure. In Jesus' name. Amen. And Father, we do pray for Daisy. We pray for Bishop Christopher, for Ian and I, as we prepare for the interview on the 12th. Father, we just pray, Lord, for that interview. We just lift it to you now, Lord Jesus. Prayers they'd like to share, just raise an arm and Liz will come to you.
Jesus, we just give thanks for your love, for your people, for this church, Lord, and we thank you for your wonderful care and love and faithfulness to us all here in good times and in difficult times. And Lord Jesus, we praise you for your just wonderful timing, and we praise you for bringing Josh here to work and be and become friendly and with all of our children, young children that are here now, and children that we just pray, Lord, will come in the future, and families that don't yet know you. And we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, for all that he will do in this difficult time, Lord. And we just praise you for this timing and the timing for the interview to come. Lord Jesus, we leave it all in your hands, and we trust you, and we thank you for all you have done. Amen.
mystery.
Oh, the mystery. You cross the great divide to show your love for me. As you hung upon the cross, you spilled your blood for me. And now I see my sin that held you there, it has no hold on me. For you rose again, and now you have the victory. Forever I will sing, thank you, thank you, thank you for the cross. Now I love you, Jesus. You have won my heart. This is one.
Please take a seat. Our second speaker this morning is Pete Luther from Revive Newport, and he's got a message for us, an update on Revive and Food Bank. So sit tight and...
Good morning, church. Sorry, I can't be with you this morning in person. I have three or four very good reasons why I can't be there. Family must come first at this time of my life. But I did want to share with you some of the things that are happening with Revive, some of the exciting things that are happening, just to keep you up to date with some of the stuff that's going. But let me start by just saying a massive thank you to all of you here this morning, watching online. St. Paul's have been a real key church, a key example to other churches about how it is to support Revive. And your partnership with us has been really, really key, particularly the last 4 or 5 years while we've been running Newport Youth Cafe in your building. That particularly has been a massive blessing to us. You know, Newport Youth Cafe probably wouldn't exist or have been able to continue if it wasn't for you and your generosity letting us have all our equipment and all our stuff there and keeping that project alive, but also your financial support, your prayer support, your inviting me to your church to speak and to share and to keep me updated, and yeah, it's just I've really felt that connection with you as we've partnered together to reach out to the people in our community, to share the love of Jesus in practical ways, to be a listening ear, to be a support, to be a safe place for people to come to and to be looked after and to be valued and to be listened to and encouraged and supported and all the kind of things that we as the church want to be for our community as we find practical ways of explaining and sharing the love of Jesus with people. So what's new? So lots of things are new with Revive. We have had a crazy 6 months. Not only have I had twins, etc., but Revive has, you know, the living room has been closed. Newport Youth Cafe has now gone online, and so for a while we were online, you know, 2 or 3 times a week. But more recently, we have been going out to the park. So we are in the park now, ready on Wednesday, ready to meet the young people, just waiting for them to arrive. And we have a lot of fun with them, just chatting, catching up in person, which is really good to be able to do. And with the living room closed, it's been quite a significant stop and change, and a change of pace, really. I think when pandemics happen, often the church rise up and the people, the Christians, like put themselves at risk to go and support people. And I think if I didn't have my family, but I would definitely be have played it very differently. But actually, the way Revive has happened, the way things have happened, I've been able to just focus on family life and protecting them that need protection. You know, twins were born very early, etc., etc. So anyway, things have changed, and it has given us an opportunity to just kind of stop, to reflect, and to think about how we're going to continue with Revive. And we have made some big decisions about some changes that we're going to do with Revive. The first is this, that the bookshop has sadly, we've decided to bring that to a close, to an end. We really love what we were able to do with the bookshop over the 6 and a bit years that we have been opened. Yeah, it's been great just to be able to serve the Christian community with cards, books, gifts. And I think that's been a really valued ministry, not only just for the 6 years we've been involved, but the 30, I think, 6 years that Castle Books was doing what they're doing. And I think, you know, although that's coming to a close, I think that is more to do with the fact that times have changed, that people are buying stuff online and can buy anything very quickly next day online, and at a cheaper price than we can do. So that there's not, it's just, we cannot compete with that. And we still kind of believe in that ministry, and with COVID and the restrictions that would be in place, running that and the cafe, just it financially would not have worked for us. And so in some respects that decision was made for us, but in some respects it's just the way it is. The next thing that has we've decided is we are going to reopen the living room, which is very exciting, because at one point we were just, how are we going to do this and make it financially viable? But we are going to open the living room, but at limited times. And so we're just going to open the living room 3 lunchtimes. So that's going to be Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday lunchtimes between 11 and 2. And we're focusing on basically the times that we know that we're busy, and we're going to just employ people to run that time. We're having to say goodbye to our volunteers. We just felt like that was just the right thing to do, and we're just going to have a new fresh team, and we're just going to start afresh and do things a little bit differently, with exactly the same ethos of loving people, caring for people, making people feel special, giving them a unique lovely experience of coming to a cafe, but a community cafe, so they can be have opportunity to talk and chat, and all at reasonable prices. We're having a few alterations happening, which is quite exciting. We're having some work done, so we're hoping to, our dream is to open in 4 weeks, or reopen in 4 weeks, there's a lot to do still. But yeah, you can see from some of the overlay image that it's beginning to make way. And one of the, some of the differences is that we're going to be able to have cooked food on the menu, and the facilities to have different items to buy, and that should help cover costs as well as attract more people. We're really going to focus on what we are specifically about as Revive, about being a unique safe place for people to come to socially distantly be together, and we want to value people and love people and care for people in a really good and proper way. And so yeah, we're excited about being able to focus all of our energies on that. So that's exciting. I've said we're open in October. It will be end of October now, but I'm saying it's still going to be October. Let's hope that we can stick to that. But we'll see how things go with the renovations, and how the world is going to maybe restrict us, who knows. But yeah, we're ready. We will be ready to open at the end of this month. And then the final thing that's happening that's different is that we're moving Newport Youth Cafe to the living room. So we've been with you guys in your Christian centre for, we think, 5 years, maybe 5.5 years, that kind of thing. It's been a really real blessing. We've had loads of young people through the door. We've helped hundreds of people in that building, and from that building probably thousands of young people have been we've been able to connect with over that time, and help them in really meaningful and really meaningful ways. And so just thank you once again for that, for your being able to allow that to happen. But we have decided that financially and in lots of other ways, bringing everything under one roof and bringing things together is a really good and new and different way of doing things. And so we are going to do that. And so when we reopen Newport Youth Cafe, it's going to be in the living room. And until that, we're going to be out and about as we continue to do. And days are going to be the same, or Wednesdays and Fridays. We're going to split the age groups into the two and have two sessions. And we're kind of putting all the COVID rules and structures and everything in place. So that's going to happen. I've got still quite a bit to do with that. But and we'll be moving stuff out of the centre and all that kind of stuff at some point. Who knows when? But over the next month. And yeah, so that's kind of exciting stuff. It's going to be different. It's going to be new. I think from going out and speaking to young people over the last like few weeks and sharing that it's going to be in the cafe opposite Phil Diner, it's come with a positive response. They know where it is, and I think that will really allow us to connect with even more young people in a deeper way than we have been able to do. So that's all very good. The one and the final thing to say is the one constant thing that we have been able to keep doing is to keep up the work of Newport Food Bank, the distribution centre at Church and Roundabout. And we've had two teams so that if anyone goes ill, they can still carry on. And although we have seen a significant drop in people using that we believe that is because the government has put some other things in place to help and support people, but that won't continue and sustain. So we are expecting and planning and preparing for another influx of people in the future. But we've been able to do that in a socially distanced way, in a different way. We've had our team have been amazing and brilliant to keep allowing that to do that. And obviously we come under the umbrella of Isle of Wight Food Bank, and our work, we're one distribution centre working for them, and that's been really good and a really valid part. Every year through Food Bank, we feed about 1,500 people. And I know you guys are having your harvest festival today, and that you are going to be collecting food for Food Bank. And so I also want to thank you for that. Thank you for giving your food to that. That's going to go to people that are really struggling and really need that. And we imagine and anticipate that need is going to grow over the coming weeks and months and lead up to Christmas particularly. It's always a time where people need that extra help and support. So thank you for that. I'd love you to continue to pray for all of that, to pray for me, to pray for the growing team, for the new members of staff we've got. So we have a new administrator just started, who you may very well know, who is really helping me and helping Paul revive together. Our finance manager has moved to Scotland, but she's still able to do that, but focusing on just finance rather the administration. Having those roles divided is really helping. And then we are looking for people to help run the cafe, as we've got one extra job which has gone out but closed by the time you've seen this. So I won't say any more about that. The points of prayer, I think, is for me and the new team, for just kind of bringing everyone together, to growing us as a team and allowing us to cope with the whole responding to the kind of COVID-19 kind of pandemic and being a response to that we'll be able to reach out to and support the people that need it, that we will be an encouragement, that we will be Jesus' hands and feet as we go out and support people, that we will have opportunities to love and serve them with no strings attached, but also we have opportunities to share our faith and to pray with people, which we have all the time, because God goes with us and God gives us this opportunity. But I'd love you to continue to pray that we have more and more opportunities. We believe Jesus is the answer to people's problems. For me, particularly over the last 6 months, have been in many respects the most amazing 6 months, with now having three under threes in my life, three boys, what a legacy. But also instead, many respects the worst of times, just because having poorly children that you can't see, and finding yourself in all kinds of different situations. I won't go into it, but it's been really hard. But God has carried me through, and God does carry us through. Our troubles are momentary, our life is fleeting, and God is going to make it all right in the end. And so trusting in God and having that perspective is what I think the world needs. And so we want to just love people and care for people and make life better for people, but we also want to help people hear about the love of Jesus, because that is what's going to change people's life. That's what's going to make people's lives better. We've got lots of other plans for the future, for growing Revive, for reaching out to the whole of our community with the whole of the church, of connecting better with the church, of connecting better with the community. But I guess that's probably for another video. Thank you for the take. Allow me to have this time to share with you. I'm sorry I couldn't be there in person, but hopefully I'll see you real soon. Blessings upon you from me. God bless.
Sing our final hymn this morning, and then we'll thank John and Pete as well. Mary, would you like to read the blessing over us this morning? Receive the blessing together.
The Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace." And in Hebrew, this should sound, Yevarech Adonai ve'yishmerecha, Yair Adonai panav elecha ve'hunecha, Yisa Adonai panav elecha, Ve'yesem lecha shalom. Father, we joy in blessing Israel from this place. And as believers who are joined through faith in Yeshua to Israel, we also receive a blessing. And we give you thanks from the bottom of our hearts. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Worship with our final hymn this morning, which is God is working his purpose out.
Lord is working.
Can we show our appreciation to John for bringing God's word to us this morning? And if Pete's watching at home, we'll give him a clap as well. Thank you, Pete. If you would like any prayer after this morning's service, please do come and see either Ian or I, and we will arrange for somebody to pray with you. And if you're watching online as well, please contact us and somebody will pray for you. You got some notices?
Yes, I have. Shoebox appeal. Thank you very much for the donations that have come in so far. The box is still outside in the porch for any other donations throughout the time. A reminder about the coffee morning quiz, which will be on the 17th of this month, 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock. And the details for how you log into Zoom will come about in the next week or so. So all proceeds from that will go to funding the shoebox appeal. So thank you very much for joining in and having some fun with that.
Just some other notices just to flag up and bring to your attention. Our church APCM will be happening on Wednesday the 14th of October at 7:30 p.m. And do pray for our interview with Dozy on the 12th of October. That's next Monday, the 12th of October. We're actually going to call a day of prayer and fasting on that day as well. So we're just going to call you to prayer and fasting that day as well. One other thing just to mention, Rivi Litvin's teaching is still available on a Thursday evening. It's happening every other week. If you're interested in joining that, then please let us know and we'll make sure that Rivi sends you the Zoom link. Thank you to Kevin for the newsletter, which comes through via post or via email every week. He does a fantastic job with that. And if you do want to make an offering this morning to Food Bank, then the plate is at the back of the church. If you want to make sure you label it or put it in an envelope that says for Food Bank, then that will go to Food Bank. And then the rest of the collection obviously comes into our church offering as well. Are we done, aren't we?
I think so.
I think just to say, just to remind you that next Sunday morning is worship and communion, and Canon Stuart Holt will be with us for that.
Good.
I think we're done.
That's good.
Fantastic. Have a great week, everybody, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Thank you very much.